Hey guys, welcome back to Learn Python the Hard Way. Today we're going to focus on exercise 22. And this exercise, this chapter is going to be a little different compared to the previous ones, because in this exercise we're actually going to recap what we did so far. So the exercise is to basically go through every exercise we did so far in the previous videos and basically recap what we did so far and write down every new word or every new symbol, every new function that we learned about, so that we have it in memory and so that we can basically recap that. And we should make sure that our list of symbols is complete so that we have everything covered. And then next to each word or symbol, we should write down its name and what it does so that we can memorize it and that we have it available when we're using it going forward. And once we've created that list, we should spend a few days to rewrite the list and to double check that everything is correct. That may get a little boring, but it's really important to get the fundamentals right so that we can rely on it and use it going forward for future exercises. And then once we memorize the list, it's important that we are able to actually remember them and also use them from memory, so that we don't have to research those basic capabilities, but have them handy and available all the way. So let's get started and actually recap what we did in the previous exercises. We initially started out with a setup chapter, and there we learned some basics about how we can navigate and work from the terminal. So we learned about how we can create a new directory using make directory, mkdir. We also learned about how we can change to a different directory and how we can navigate using cd, which stands for change directory. And we learned about how we can list files or directories within a certain folder by using ls, which stands for list. Then we also learned how we can, from the terminal, switch over to the idle environment using Python 3. So the name of the Python version you want to use, and that can be really handy if you want to quickly try out some code. And to get back from the idle environment to the terminal itself, we just typed out quit with parentheses to get back to the previous terminal window and to be able to, for example, navigate then to another folder. In the first exercise, actually in the next chapter, we learned about how we can use the print function to print out some text, some string, and also how we can execute a file using Python 3, followed by the name of the Python file that we want to exercise or want to execute. After that, in exercise 2, we learned about using comments, using the pound character, and after the pound character, we can then provide the comment, and that will be ignored when the code file is executed, but it can be handy to document what we're actually doing. In exercise 3, we learned about numbers and math. Here we learned about the different math symbols available to us. So for example, plus, minus, divided by, multiplied, modulo, so the remainder operator, and also the Boolean comparison operators, so smaller, greater, smaller than or equal, and greater than and equal. And we also learned how we can combine that in the print statement so that we can, for example, print out a string, as we did in some of the previous exercises, combined with some additional input, for example, a number here where we can do some calculation and print that out after the string. After that, in exercise number 4, we learned about variables and names. And we started, for example, by defining a number of different variables, for example, the cars variable, by just assigning cars to a certain value. And then we define that variable and can use it in our script going forward. In exercise 5, we build on top of what we learned about variables, and we learned about how we can print out those variables. And here, for the first time, we learned about printf, so the format string, which allows us to print out a string and directly embed a variable inside of that string. We have to make sure that in front of the string we use the F character, and then inside of the string we can use the curly braces, and within those curly braces we would provide the name of the variable that we want to embed into the string. In exercise number 6, we learned about strings and text. So here we learned another way how we can embed some text or some variables within a string. So here, for example, we have a hilarious variable that we defined. It's a Boolean variable with a value of false. And then we have a string that we defined. And within that string, we added some curly braces. And then by printing out that string, which is stored in this variable, and calling format on the string and passing in the value that we want to insert into those curly braces, we basically accomplish something very similar to the format string that we learned about in the previous exercise, but here we use another way to accomplish that using format and then passing in that Boolean variable. We build on top of that in exercise number 7, and here we learned about that we can, when we use the print statement, provide an optional argument called end, and this allows us to change the default end character of the print statement. So by default, we would have a new line, so that if we print something, it would print out the string that we provide and then insert a new line. But we can change that end character and, for example, insert a space character as we're doing here, and then we would not have a new line at the end, but just a space character. And of course, we can use the print statement also to combine multiple variables together. So here we stored variables in individual characters in a variable and then chain them together within the print statement. We built on top of that in exercise number 8 and constructed some a little more complicated strings. For example, here we had a formatter variable, which includes 4 curly braces, which again are kind of placeholders. And using the format function here, we then passed different values to it. So for instance, some numbers, 1, 2, 3, and 4, which were then inserted into formatter and printed out. And instead of that, of course, we were also able to use other values, for example, Boolean values, true and false. Or in some other cases, we also used, for example, variables that included some stored values. After that, we learned how we could use a print statement for multi-line strings by using 3 quotation marks and then inserting our string, which can span multiple lines. And we ended that multi-line string by again inserting 3 string characters. So that can be very handy if we have a very long print statement and we don't want to insert separate print statements, but we basically want to include that in one statement. And then we would use those 3 quotation marks at the beginning and at the end of the print statement. In exercise 10, we learned how we can work with escape sequences. So for instance, we learned that we could insert \t to insert a tab within a string, or for example, that we could escape \characters by inserting another \ in front of them. And of course, there are other escape sequences, for example, \n to insert a new line. In exercise 11, we learned about asking questions and for the first time how to collect user input. We used the input function for that. Input followed by open and closed parentheses, and that opened a new window basically, or actually collected some input from the user that the user could provide, and that provided input, which is saved as a string, is then stored in a variable, in this case, for example, in the variable age. Building on top of this in exercise 11, we learned that we can actually give some more context to our users by passing some string to the input function. So within those parentheses, we entered some string, and that string was then shown to the users when they were going to enter some text. So here, for example, we asked the user for the age, and as the user entered that, he saw the string that we entered here. So how old are you? And then after that, the user could enter the age, and it was then stored in the age variable. We did the same for the height and the weight variable, and all of that was afterwards printed out using printf, where again we embedded the different variables within our strings. In exercise 13, for the very first time, we learned how we can import external capabilities from various modules, and we started out by importing argv from the sys module. And argv allowed us to work with command line arguments so that as we executed our files, we could pass some additional arguments to it. And we build then on top of that, of course, in the subsequent exercises, for example, to work with files and to provide additional values. To build on top of that, we learned about prompting and parsing. In particular, we learned that we could define a prompt very easily just by using a variable, and then we could pass that variable to the input function here. And similar to how we directly could pass a string to it, we could of course also pass a string stored in a variable. And the benefit here was that we could very easily change the prompt, for example, that we used in multiple places by just changing it in one space in this variable. And wherever we used input prompt, it was then changed in all those places at once. Then we learned about how we could work with files in Python and how we could open files. So by calling the open function here and providing a file name, we could open a file and store it, for example, as a file object in a variable called txt. And then also we learned how we could actually read that file and print out the content of the file itself. To build on top of that, we learned about how we could not only read files, but also write files. And by default, if we call open without providing anything else other than the file name, the file was opened in read mode. But if, for example, we pass w as an additional argument to it, then we open that file in write mode and could then make some changes to that file. We learned about the truncate method, which basically emptied the file. And then most importantly, we learned about how we could write a new file by calling write and passing in the text or the variable that we actually wanted to write into the file. And very importantly, at the end of working with a file, we always need to make sure that we close the file. So that's the last step here, to call the close function to actually close our file. And we also learned for the first time about the seek function, which allows us to move to a certain location within our file, which became important in one of the subsequent exercises where we actually read out the entire file and then wanted to go back to the beginning of the file to read out each line. And to accomplish that, we used seek and passed a value of 0 to it. Building on top of that, we learned about another module called OSPath. And from there, we imported the exists capability. And that helped us to figure out if a certain file exists. We used it here, for example, in a print statement where we called exists and we passed a file name to it. And if the file existed, then it printed out true. Otherwise, it printed out false. So it can be very handy to use in order to determine if a file actually already exists or maybe not. And then we started learning about a very important concept, the concept of working with functions. We learned about that we can define a function by providing a range of arguments, pretty much, which we can then assign to different variables, or alternatively that we could directly provide the different arguments here. So for example, in this case, we have two arguments. And of course, it's also possible to define a function without any arguments, which, for example, just would print out a certain statement. And we always use the def keyword in front to define a new function, followed by the name of the function, which has to start with either a letter or an underscore. It is not allowed to start it off with a letter, with a number at the beginning. But of course, we could insert a number a little bit later, just not as the first character. After that, we added a colon here at the end, And then we indented the next line by 4 space characters and inserted basically the function body. And here, for example, we had a print statement where we printed out certain information. And then we basically end this function definition by going back to the beginning of the file here. So we stop the indentation and actually move just to the outdented level, to the default level. And in order to call our function or work with our functions, we then provided the function name and passed the so-called arguments to them. So here we provided the values that should be used within the function. In the subsequent exercise, we then learned how we could combine functions and variables by defining a function and passing the arguments to the function, and within the function body here, we could then, of course, work with those arguments that we provided. And most importantly, if we defined some variables, of course, we could pass those variables then directly to the function. So it's not only possible to pass values directly, as we did in the previous exercise with those strings, but instead we were also able to pass variables directly to our function. In exercise 20, we then worked with functions and files, and we learned about readline, which reads a file one line at a time, and is really handy if we, for example, want to print out a file one line at a time, or if you want to make some changes to each line of a file. And we also learned about how we can increment numbers, how we can increase, for example, a variable by a value of 1, by using the shorthand notation plus equals, which is the same as if we said, in this case, current line equals current line plus 1. Instead, we can just say current line plus equals 1, which increases the value of current line by 1. And then finally, in the last exercise, we learned that functions can return something. So instead of just printing out some information, we can actually return back a value, which can then be stored in a variable. So for instance, we defined an add function here that takes 2 arguments. And then at the end of our function, we use the return keyword to return, in this case, the sum of A and B. And this returned value, of course, can be stored in a variable. So here, for example, we called add and passed 30 and 5 to it. And this return value is then stored in the H variable. So these are the concepts that we learned about so far. And it's important to recap that and really commit it to memory. So how we can define a function, for example, so that we have it handy as we go forward, as we learn about more complicated concepts. And it's always important, if we commit something like that to memory, to understand why we do that actually. So here in this case, we really learn about the names of the symbols and commit them to memory so that we can read the source code more easily. So it's comparable to learning the alphabet or basic words in English, except for Python, this has extra symbols that we want to know. And if we are familiar with that, then we can really write code much more fluently, and it will be much easier to read and write code going forward. And so the author recommends to take 15 minutes at a time to review the list of the different functions, of the different symbols that we used, and learn that every day so that we commit it to memory, and then we have that available and can use it and can write more complicated statements, more complicated scripts going forward. So that's it for exercise 22, and see you guys in the next video with exercise 23.